Good morning to all of you. Listen, yesterday I spoke at Downey Calvary Chapel, and it had to do with the enemy. So I want to just share with you that I'm not lazy, I'm not negligent. I thought the message was appropriate, and it had to be transformed and changed. I had something else, but I just felt it was such a matter of urgency. There's military terms that are used here by Paul the Apostle. Spiritual warfare, a spiritual war, as a battlefield. All these terms and euphemisms have to do with the military. And then I sat here, and then I saw two CCMers here, Hilton and Gil from Montebello Calvary Chapel, and they were there last night, and I felt a little embarrassed. I go, you're probably going to hear the same thing. However, when Jeff came in here and started talking about PTSD, he hit it right on the nail. That was a confirmation for me. And then about the ministry you're going to be having pretty soon, a spiritual warfare, that was another confirmation. And so I believe with all my heart that God has honor for me to change the message. I don't want to feel like a second-class speaker. You know, I'm using some old manna for you, and I don't think it is. It is very important, very timely. Anyone who calls himself a Christian, at one time or another, you're going to have to face the battlefield. One time or another, Satan is going to come to you. You're nobody special. The moment you become a Christian, automatically, by default, you have become a target. And the enemy is a foe, F-O-E, not Vietnamese soup, foe. F-O-E is an enemy. An enemy has no neutrality. The enemy has one objective: to kill you and destroy you, or maim you, paralyze you, or keep you in suspended animation with your own stupidities. That is the target, and that is the aim of the enemy. And he also adds also mental and psychological weapons. They're called fiery darts. Those fiery darts are the residual characteristics like shame and embarrassment, because there's something inside of you. It's a battle going on. And I want to just share with you, I want to read three scriptures to you, because I want to make reference to them as I speak. And so the first one is in Matthew chapter 13, verse 24. And then I'll take you to Acts chapter 5. And then I'll take you to Ephesians chapter 6, verses 11, 12, and 13. Now, it's been said that in order for one to understand real doctrine, there's a very simple rule. What is doctrine? Well, if it's mentioned in the Gospels, is it practiced in the book of Acts, the first church? Is it mentioned in the epistles? Was it talked about in the Gospels? Is it mentioned or practiced or brought about in the book of Acts? And is it mentioned in any of the epistles? That is a very simple rule. It's doctrine. And so here we find in Matthew chapter 13, an encounter as Jesus shares a parable. And in this parable, don't feel bad if you don't understand it. You'll see that the disciples, they go, huh, they didn't get it either. Verse 24 of Matthew chapter 13. Another parable Jesus put forth to them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in this field. But while man slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the grain had sprouted and produced a crop, then the tares or weeds also appeared. So the servants of the owner came and said to him, sir, did you not plant good seeds in your field? How then does it have tares? And the master said, an enemy has done this. The servant said to him, do you want us then to go and gather them up? But he said, no, lest while you're gathering the tares, you may uproot the wheat with them, you know, accidentally. Let them both grow together until the harvest. At the end of the harvest, I will say to the reapers, first gather together the tares and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. So you may say, wow, trip out. I don't get it. I know. You're not alone. Neither the disciples. Now notice verse 36. Then Jesus sent the multitudes away and went inside the house. What I see here is that Jesus sent the wannabes, the looky-loos. These are the people that want to follow Jesus for different reasons. They are followers of Jesus, and then they are disciples of Jesus. They're wannabe Christians. They're the looky-loos. These insignificant people who really were not following Jesus, they're called the multitude, and they left. Now, what Jesus ends up with are the real hardcore, the OGs, and they stand there. These are the real people that want to change, and they're inquiring, well, what was that parable? Because I'm tripping. I don't get it. And notice what happens. They said, explain to us the parable of the tares of the field. In other words, bring it down a couple of clicks. We don't get it. And he says everything here. You don't have to have a commentary, a theologian. This is any kid, over the age of 6 years old, understands it. It's very simple. So here's a breakdown of what Jesus meant. Verse 37. He answered and said to them, he who sows, the word sows means planting. He who sows the good seed is the who? The Son of Man. The field is the what? The seeds are the what? The sons of the kingdom. Who are the tares? The tares are the sons of who? So we got two different sons, the sons of the kingdom and the sons of the wicked. Verse 39, he defines the enemy. The enemy who sowed them is who? The harvest is the when? And the reapers are? The angels. And so he continued to explain, very simple, that the enemy only wants to disrupt, destroy, and ravish the work of God. Now, I, for one, you need to have this disclaimer. Though Satan should never, under any circumstance, be given undue prominence, it is important that the place given to him in Scripture be realized, like today. You know, when you study the Bible, we have bibliology. You want to study Jesus Christ? Christology. You want to study the works of God? Theology. You want to learn about the doctrine of salvation? Astrology. You want to know about the doctrine of the Holy Spirit? Numenology. And so you want to know the end times? Eschatology. But do you know there's also another division of learning the Bible? It's called Satanology, demonology, angelology. They're very important. Paul the Apostle told the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians 2:11, he says, don't let Satan take advantage of us. For we are not ignorant of his devices, schemes, evil plots, or in a military parlance, it's called stratagem. A stratagem is when you trick the enemy to do something and then you pounce on them, and that's how the enemy works. Paul says, very confident, for we are not ignorant of his tactics. We are not ignorant of his tactics. Now, when you say ignorant, we have made that word into something foolish. Man, you're ignorant. No, ignorant is not lacking intelligence, not being stupid. Like, let me ask you. You won't know this answer. You think you know, but you don't know this answer. Do you know who won the Super Bowl? Yes or no? No. You may wish Denver wins it. I'm LA. I don't know. Not my Super Bowl. You can have it. Ain't no fun. It's nothing exciting. Nothing. It's just be careful with the Budweiser. Just be wiser tomorrow. That's it. And so the enemy is a sworn enemy. There's no neutrality. Somebody who hates or seeks to harm somebody or something. A person or a group, especially a military force that fights another in combat or battle. It's either him or you. There's no decisiveness. He's there to kill you, to destroy you, maim you, or basically stabilize you. What's another stabilizing? Just unable for you to do any kind of fighting. He can put you in a suspended animation. What is suspended animation? Well, animation is when you move, like a cartoon, you move. But when you're suspended, guess what you're doing? You're moving, but you're going nowhere. And that's the trick of the enemy, to make you feel like you're occupied. It's like a fly through the spider web. You get caught and you move a lot. The more you move, the more the spider says, move on. Because the more you're in the net, the more you're in the web site. Go on. You're my dinner now. And later on, that spider goes after that fly has already fought and they're weak. And that's when the spider to the fly goes in there. And you're gone. And that is the essence of the enemy. Now go with me to Acts chapter 5. And we'll read another verse. Chapter 5 of the book of Acts. I won't wait for you. You catch up to me. But a certain man named Ananias with Sapphira, his wife, sold a possession. And he kept back part of the proceeds. His wife also being aware of it and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled your heart to what? To lie to the who? Well, the Holy Spirit, and keep back part of the price of the land for yourself. While it remained, wasn't it your own? And after it was sold, was it not your own control? Why have you conceived this thing in your heart? You have not lied to men, but you have lied to who? To God. Then Ananias, that's a man's name, hearing this, those words fell down and breathed his last. So great fear came upon all those who heard this thing. You better believe it. Verse 6. And the young men arose and wrapped him up, carried him, and buried him, which is very usual today in Israel. You die the same day they bury you. They don't have mortuary homes. You die that day they bury you. And then so Peter, verse 7, and it was about 3 hours later on when his wife came in, not knowing what was happening. And Peter answered her, tell me whether you sold the land for so much. And look at her. She said, yes, for so much. She was implicated on this scheme with her husband. Then Peter said to her, how is it that you have agreed together to test the spirit of the Lord? Look, the feet of those who have buried your husband are at the door, and they will carry out to, and boom, immediately she conked out, and his feet breathed her last. And the young men came in and found her dead, and carrying her buried with her by her husband. So great fear came upon all the church and upon all those who heard these things. It all started with Ananias. The question was this: why have you allowed Satan to fill your heart to lie? So now, mention the gospel, mention the book of Acts. Now let's see if it's gospel, if it's doctrine. Go with me to Ephesians chapter 6. Chapter 6, verse 10. He says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Whose strength, whose might? Not yours. It is God's divine, celestial, unique strength. It's not muscle power. It's not gold gyms. It's not that kind of bulkiness. It's not brawniness. Has nothing to do with you being big and you're tall and you can hack and you can hang. It had nothing to do with that. Has everything to do with eternal strength. It's a fortitude that God gives you, the strength during the times when you have to flight, when you have to fight, or when you have to fright. God will give you the ability, the endowment to say yes with so much courageousness when everybody says no. God will give you the ability to say yes. God will also give you the strength to have that magical word, no. And if you're polite, you'll add that, no, thank you. Why? Because it's bad for you. Because it ruins my marriage. Because it ruins me. It ruins my head. It ruins my relationship. And you make that judicial reasoning, not because you're smart, not because you went to a two-year junior college, not because you went to Bible school. It is all have to do with the endowment and the grace and the love and the goodness that God gives to you. And that strength is needed today because men don't have that kind of strength anymore. So Paul says, I want you to be strengthened by the Lord's might. Verse 11, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Straight up. Chapter 13, Jesus is the devil. Acts, Peter asks, why has Satan filled your heart? And here Paul says, do not wrestle, forgive me, put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Now, I have to be honest with you. I read the Bible when I got saved. There are so many English words that I didn't understand. I shared this time and time again, but it's worth mentioning again. Because you may be a brand new Christian, and you look at the Bible, you say, man, this is very daunting, man, it scares me. I don't understand if I'm going to be able to understand this. Listen, not only will you be able to understand it and comprehend it, but you'll hear the voice of God through God's word. You will learn those words. We have now apps now on your phone. You have now apps. They're good for you. And you can go into the book of Daniel Webster's, and find out what is wiles. The word wiles basically means craftiness, cunningness, which means that Satan, the devil, he is sly, slick, and wicked. He's cunning. Having read those scriptures, let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, may you now take full control of our faculties. Speak to the believer and the non-believer as well, and anoint my lips, my words, my memory, and of course, your living word. Speak to us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, we saw in the parables, we saw here that the essence of Satan is to destroy the work of God. Satan is the author of sin in the world. The devil tempts men to sin. The devil lays snares for men to get trapped. The devil puts wicked purposes into the hearts of men. According to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, Satan blinds the minds of the unbelieving world. It is the work of Satan to blind the minds of men, especially unbelievers, so they cannot see the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. But it equally, in contrast, it is the job of the Holy Spirit to open your eyes, to enlighten you so that you may see the truth for what it is. Warfare. Spiritual warfare, we are told. You see, what does he look like? The Bible doesn't tell us what Satan looks like. Images of Satan or the devil with horns and a pitchfork are inaccurate according to the Bible. The devil's clearest trick, the most cleverest trick, is to make men believe that he does not exist. That's his trick. Just a figment of imagination, man. Don't worry about it. There's no such thing as the devil. If you're a Christian, Jesus talked about it. He encountered him in Matthew chapter 4. You saw in the book of Acts it affected the church, and you'll see later on some other things. You'll see later on when Paul says that we not need to be ignorant. Here's how he described his own agenda, Paul the apostle, when there was a lady who came upon him with devil oppression. And finally he rebuked the devil, and this is what Paul said. He said, all full of deceit, and you fraud, you son of the devil, you enemy of all righteousness, will you not cease perverting the straight ways of the Lord? Acts 13:10. There he described them. You're full of deceit, you're deceitful, you're fraudulent, you're an enemy of all righteousness, and you want to pervert and distort the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, I'm not concerned about how the enemy looks like. Now, having gone to the Marine Corps, in the height of Vietnam, I joined in 69, but I entered boot camp in January 1970. Well, I graduated from boot camp, and then I graduated from infantry school. And then from infantry school, we went to jungle survival because everyone had WESPAC orders, thus parlance in the military for Western Pacific Theater. It was no shows, no movie. It was a theater, they call it. There's a campaign right now. We have a theater in Afghanistan that Americans are still fighting, are still being killed as we speak. And so everyone had orders when I graduated. Everyone had orders, Westpac. There were people that were so disillusioned. Oh, but they gave me a promise that I'm going to be stationed in Hawaii. No, you're going straight to Nam. But they told me I was going to be stationed in Yuma, Arizona. No, Charlie, you're going to go. And you end up either in the Philippines, you go to Japan, but eventually we end up in the bush. And that's the separation took place. And so when I was there in jungle survival, I was part of the ongoing training, extensive training, because we were entering into a different dynamic of engagement. We were now dealing with guerrilla warfare, something that was not conventional. And so having had the experiences from 66, 67, 68, 69, we have now cases where we study them. And as we study the cases, we knew the enemy. What were their names? What's the difference between NVA and Viet Cong? What was the difference about them? What is their modus operandi? How do they operate? How do they look? We want to know what kind of weaponry they have. We want to know what kind of movement do they do. And so we needed to know everything about the enemy. And this is what Paul says. We are not ignorant, which means that you're not informed. If you as a Christian are not informed what the enemy does and what he does and how he does it, and then it could be very alarming, because you blame everything on the pipe. You blame everything in the way you brought up. You blame it on your old lady. Forgive me, your wife. You blame it on your mom. You blame it on your dad. You blame it on mama. And you blame it on Obama. It stopped. You cannot do that. We're engaged in a warfare. And Jesus told us that. Paul warns us about it. There are things in our life that just hinders us. He says, put on the whole armor of God. Why? So that you can stand against the schemes of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood. That's hand-to-hand combat. It's not wrestling what you see today, phony wrestling. This is called the Greco-Roman wrestling called grappling. Did I say that right? Grappling? Grappling is when someone starts grappling you. And what they do in that sport is to make sure they put you on a key and hold you down until you tap out, until you realize, I can't move. And Lord willing, maybe your pinky, maybe your hand, maybe your palm, when you do this and you tap out, you tell homeboy, get off of me, man, I'm down. That's what wrestling means. Paul says, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. What does that mean, flesh and blood? It means we're not dealing in the physical realm. You see, if you see me, I see you. And all of a sudden you throw a blow at me for no reason because I look like an enemy. And you come at me, I can see you. And Lord willing, I'm fast enough to duck and move out of the way. And Lord willing, I have control that I just run. But if the hood comes out, you know, it's natural. It's natural. That happened. Somebody rushed on our stage on the platform, and he came rushing at me. And instead of saying, oh, my brother, what's wrong with you? I just, whoa, boom. It just came out. And I said, oh, my God. Yeah, well, I'm so sorry, man. Get him safe before you kick him out. So a lot of us don't know the origin of Satan. We don't know his personality, character. We don't know his agenda, his target. We don't know his tactics. We don't even know his weapons. We don't even know his nom de guerre, which means the names of war. He has many names. Schemer, liar, the beast, many names. And first of all, how do we fight against him? Or do we fight? Here, Paul says, put on the whole armor of God, but you're not going to fight him. He says, just make sure you stand. And keep standing. Notice this. He says, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities. Secondly, against powers. Third, against the rulers of the darkness of this age. Fourth, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, because you're fighting something you cannot see, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil days, and having done everything, to what? Stand. Because there's nothing more deceiving than seeing a Christian in the physical world walking and standing, but if you look at him in the spiritual entity, he's an impotent man, a powerless man, crippled by his own shame, crippled by his own mental hygiene going awry, by his own heart that is not burning with fire for Jesus Christ. You are consumed with your guilt. You are consumed with your shame. You are paralyzed from the inside out, and you feel like a second-class citizen. And when you feel like a second-class citizen, the joy comes out of you. And joy is very important in our Christian life, because joy is the strength of the Lord. You cannot not have joy. I find it so quizzical and so odd to meet Christians, and they look, they're mad dogging. What up? Yeah, man. I go to this church, and yeah. Dude, what are they serving there, dude? What, are they having lemons? What? Why are you mad dogging? What is that posture? What's all this and what's all that? That shouldn't be. So, I want you to look at something. Well, first of all, let me tell you the tri-headed attack that comes in. First, let me tell you about when I was in infantry training and jungle training. Vietnam got very personal to me. My childhood friend, Bobby, next door neighbor, literally, he went in 6 months before I did. He joined the Army because we were getting drafted, and so he wanted to beat it to the punch. So he joined the Army because his brother and uncle were in the Army. And so he went in the Army 6 months ahead of me, 5 months ahead of me. And during training, I found out that he had been KIA. And I asked permission to go to his funeral. And they gave me granted permission to go get out of my train to go to the funeral. And I found out how he died. He stepped in an IED back in those days, because it's guerrilla warfare. He stepped on a booby trap. And he was killed instantly. I didn't see his body, but when I saw the drama and I saw what it did to the mom, my friend, next door neighbor, Vietnam was now part of me. It came close to my house, very, very close. So imagine my mental state when I went back to my training. When I went back to my training, I believe I was the most highest recruit there, very attentive and knowing the enemy, because now it was personal. I wanted to know the nomenclature of every weapon. I want to find out what weapon they use. I want to know what weapon are we going to be used. And we fired every weapon available in those days in Vietnam, every weapon available during the Vietnam War. I was able to practice. I was able to hear it. I was able to feel it. I was able to feed it so that we can engage in a warfare. We also heard the weaponry that the enemy would use, an AK-47. And Kalashnikovs, rifle assaults, and the kind of grenades and the kind of grenade launchers they have. They have a different, unique sound. The capping goes down. The explosion is different sound. So you can get familiarized. So when you enter in country, when you go into the bush, or when you pass the wire, you need to know everything. Your enemy, the movement, and what they carry. You need to know the enemy, how they move. And yet in the Christian community, we don't really understand the spiritual warfare. And we blame it on our wives. We blame it on our state of mind. We blame it on our past. We blame it on our teachers and our counselors. And we put the blame game instead of saying, it's not about them. It's not about you. It's that you love Jesus Christ. And because you desire to love Jesus Christ, you're committed to Jesus Christ, and you spend a breakfast in coming to learn about Jesus Christ, guess who doesn't like that? The enemy doesn't like that. Because he seeks only to destroy and to maim and to hurt you and belittle you. That's his agenda. Now, very interesting. And this is where I wanted to share this with you. Because I made a very enlightening discovery. I've been a Christian since 1975. But when you read the Bible, you're always learning something new, man. You cannot say, oh yeah, I read that before. It don't make sense to me. Look it. I read 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, Titus, those are pastoral epistles. I read them like 2 times a month, 3 times a month. I know pastors that read that passage like every week to remind them of their position, remind them who they are as believers, because pastors have a bigger target. It's called a high-value target. The moment some of you decide, you know what, I'm going to get involved in ministry, I'm going to represent, I'm going to get down and dirty and be committed to the things of God. You think there's no bells in hell ringing in your name? The moment they said, what? Pelon is going and he is getting involved in ministry? The enemy says, oh, hell no. And they're going to send some more minions. Not Satan. Minions, demonic. Because listen, when Paul is writing to the Ephesians, he's writing to Christians. James talks about the same thing. Humble yourself before the Lord and let him exalt you. Flee from Satan and let you be covered with the clothing of humility. Satan is all reference to Christians. And we all come to that theological conclusion. Hey, I'm a Christian. Greater is he that is in me, that's of the world. I can't get possessed by Satan. True. Only those that are not Christians are open season. So if you're here as a non-believer, first let me tell you. First, if you're here as a non-Christian, you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, let me applaud you for being here. You're a trip. Because think about it, because you're probably saying this to yourself. What am I doing here? I know. I wasn't born a Christian. When I went to the first Christian environment, I was tripping, man. Oh, my gosh. These are all hallelujahs. Wow. And the men are singing. Men are singing. And some men will hold hands. I had enough. I had enough of the county, Twin Towers. I had enough of the military. The last thing I want to do is hold hands with guys. But guess what? They're hippies, man, and they got my hand. Oh, my God. I'm not a Christian, man. This is getting a little freaky. And then I said to myself, oh, homeboy, don't lift up your hands. Whatever you're doing, don't lift up. Oh, here we go. There we go. I said, oh, man. It's embarrassing, man. I said, whatever you do, home, don't do that kumbaya. Oh, here we go. Oh. It was trippy for me. I didn't understand what was going on. But the word of God came forth, then I knew. I knew then that God was calling me. I just knew it. When they asked for the invitation, there was a major hesitation because I had a lot of pride, but there was a major hesitation. I'm trying to figure things out. Why? I don't want to go up there. No way. And the guy kept saying, you need to come up. I went. My thought and philosophy at the time, I got nothing to lose and everything to gain. So I went forward. It's like that. Boom. Me and 2 girls. Transformed by the power of God. The ability to say no to things that I would readily say yes to. Then I noticed one thing. I didn't call it spiritual warfare. I just said, this is a trip-out moment. It was a spiritual warfare. Because I noticed that after I became a Christian, everybody was giving me Coke for free. It's free. Why is it free? Last week you were charging me. Why not free? Try some weed on the house. Why is it free? Everything was free on the house. Everything. I wasn't able to connect the dots. I was still too stupefied to understand that. But it was later on that I connected the dots. But God had given me the inner strength for me to say those magical phrases, no, thank you. Why? I don't know. I couldn't tell you. Well, because the enlightenment and the transformation in my mind was just, I couldn't tell you that. All I said, no. And I said to myself, oh, my God, where'd that come from? Weed, Weed too. I was a toker, midnight smoker. Weed was my buddy. Weed and me, we're tumbled together. You can never take away my weed. Why? God made it. It's from the earth. I'm green. It's organic. I'm organic. We're both organic. God made it. It's like pepper. It's like oregano. Same thing, but we smoke it. My rationale. I become a Christian. And I got my buddies there. Toking out. Here, man. Usually I'll go for it. Yeah, man. Out of nowhere. I didn't say no. I said, it's a phrase. It's a Greek word called chale. Chale. I said, no, chale, Holmes. And they said, why not? And my answer, I don't know. I don't know. I was a fish. I would drink every day. Bilingual. Johnny Walker, Jose Cuervo. I don't care. And here is the drink again. They asked me, you want some? I said, no, thank you. Really? Are you okay? I think so. Why don't you want a drink? I don't know, eh? I didn't know. It wasn't until later on that I realized I'm born again. I've been transformed and modified by the Word of God. It works. It works. Now, let me tell you, you look at across your Bible in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 26 and 27. Listen very carefully. This is what I came about. It says in verse 26, be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger or wrath. Verse 27, nor give place to the who? Okay, very interesting. The word don't give place, the word place in the Greek is topos, sounds fancy, but it's spelled T-O-P-O-S. It may not ring a bell yet, but if I tell you that that word is an extract word, the original origin of this English word that we had, topography. Now, how many know here know what topography is? How many do not know what topography is? A lot of people don't care. Satan already got a hold of you. Topography is a study of a landscape, the area, and the terrain. Topography. In the classical Greek, not the Koine Greek, but in the classical Greek, it is a military term. It means a territory that you allow the enemy to take. You have allowed the enemy to bivouac or to come and settle down in a territory for whatever reason. And that enemy soon will become an insurgent. Look at Israel. In the south, you have Hamas. In the north, you have Hezbollah. These are insurgents. These are enemies that encamp in the south and the north of Israel, and they shoot rockets left and right. They're the enemy. So Israel does not want any part of those topos in that area because they're areas where they stage and then they shoot rockets from the north and from the south. In the same way, it is a military word that says, I have allowed the enemy to take this territory. When God warns the Christians about the spiritual warfare, Satan is slick. He is highly sophisticated. He's not going to get dressed up all ugly looking and scare you like Linda Blair in the movie Exorcist. He's going to come in camouflage. He will come maybe look like a smoking pipe. He will come looking like a fancy lady. And guys, listen. You don't have it anymore, some of you. I'm being real. There was a time when you looked good. And then if you know you're not that good looking anymore, you don't attract, you're not magnetic anymore. But someone finds you and she's fine looking, and you go, wow, you know, I still got it. You know, wow. I don't think so. If you're a married man, that's a devil with a blue dress on. The devil camouflages his ways. Let me tell you the areas where we allow Satan to take advantage. We allowed him to take our topos, our territory. We yieldfully said, you can hang here. I know you're my enemy, but I'll keep an eye on you. How can that be? Oh, it could be lust. It could be anger. It could be pride. It could be a blemished conscience. It could be a myriad of things. You stay here. This is my past. But my past don't have nothing to do with me. Demons, what they want to do is strategize how to make whatever weakness you have, they want to take it to the advantage and take it to the ninth degree to bully you, to mess with you, to harass with you. And here we are. We always come out saying, the magical chapter, 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of all sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I've said that hundreds, if not thousands of times since 1975. But yet, we go back at it again. And we're in this yo-yo complex. We go back and we feel miserable. We know it ain't right. We know that. You see, Paul had the same dilemma. We're not alone. Paul said, there's a conflict in me, the dilemma of man, Romans chapter 7. He says, I know how to do good. I know what to do right. But there's something telling me inside of me like an enemy that causes me to do those things that are not right. So when you know how to do right and yet you're practicing what is wrong, it brings a crushing dilemma of madness. I know I should say I'm sorry, but I say, you know, I say something else. I know that I should humble myself, but I do something else. He says, those things that I should know and how to do, I don't practice that. He says, who can lift me of this wretchedness? And he gives the answer, only the Lord Jesus Christ. So I believe that you're a Christian. You love God. You're like Peter. Peter loves God, and yet Satan says, Simon, Simon, Satan has asked you by name. He wants to sift you as wheat. But behold, I have prayed for you. And after you come through the testing, go and speak to your brothers and exhort them by that experience. I mean, if I was Peter, I said, what did I do to him? Why is this crazy guy wants to talk to me? Because you're now a child of the light. And the enemy has come to destroy you, to maim you, to brutalize you. And how Satan works, he operates on pride or knowledge, anger or bitterness, self-pity or sorrow, selfishness and greed, lack of self-control. What does that mean? Unrestrained sensual appetite of the lower nature. I don't get it. That means your horniness is over the top and over the line. That's what it means. Because a lot of people say, what is the appetite of the lower nature? Well, we have an upper nature. Food, oxygen, water. Lower nature, we don't eat water. Lower nature. And the appetite is supposed to be for your wife. And the appetite goes after things that Satan prepares for you. Because you have left that territory open. You left that door open. So instead of just saying, Lord, forgive me, I confess my sin, and okay. But what about these demons in your backyard? Oh, I gave him permission. No, you see, there has to be an admission. Secondly, there has to be an acknowledgement. Third, there has to be a confession. Fourth thing, there has to be a renouncing. Like Paul said in 2 Corinthians 4:2, but we have renounced the hidden things of shame. We have renounced. There's denouns, pronouns, announce, but he says, we have renounced no more. You say it loud. We have renounced the hidden things of shame. So instead of just asking God, Lord, I acknowledge my sin, I confess my sin, I admit it, but I also renounce the hidden things of shame. And then the last thing, the volitional willingness to surrender the territory back to God. What is it that you know you're playing with? What is it? What keeps you from walking to the Lord straight up? What keeps you? You see, I was perverted at the age of 11 years old. I was damaged at the age of 11 years old. From that moment on, I enter into a world of perversion until I was 24 years old. I don't have to tell you what perversion is, but it was deviance, moral, sexual. And that's why it passed on to alcoholism, because I couldn't shut the embarrassment, the shame. I couldn't tell my mother. I couldn't tell my best friends. I couldn't tell them anything. It was just a tormenting soul crying out from the inside. And I blame everything, my inadequacies. I blame everything on that act, my father deserting our family. And I blame everybody. And that's why I was renouncing just everything. I said, Lord, I take everything from me. And I thought that was it. No, there's a battle going on every single day of your life. A lot of you are going to go back home, and then you're going to see chaos. You're going to see confusion, a little argument. You're going to find something. You're going to say, man, I just went to church, man. What happened here? Duh. Put the light on. That's what Pancho was speaking about. So don't freak. Don't blame your kids. Don't blame your wife. Don't blame your boss. Don't blame your mama or Obama. Look at it for what it is. My wife and I don't argue on Saturday night. Not because we're so smart. Because we know that God, that Satan wants to disable me on Saturday so I don't have to teach on Sunday mat dogging. On Wednesdays, all Wednesdays, my wife and I, we're like friends. We know that when we argue, we say, oh. We understand. Every fool can start a fight, but it takes a wise person to stop one. I said, sorry about that. No, I'm sorry. We are so polite. And if you were to walk in there, wow, do you live like this every day? No, it's only on Wednesdays and Saturdays. Why? Because we understand how the enemy works. Our children make decisions that you go, what? And we said, Lord Jesus, they're in your hand. We brought them in the right way, they're in your hand. Because you know kids, they know more than you do. Your own kids, you said the same to your parents. Oh, shut up, you don't know. And now your own kids are like, oh, you're old. There's a gap between us, you don't get it. Okay. I've been around, man. The dog that bit you was a puppy when it bit me. Hey, I've been around. My daughter came up to you and goes, hey, Dad, have you ever heard this Beatles song? I got all the Beatles song here, man. I need that. And so today, as I close, listen. I want to get personal. There's some of you here that are not believers. And I have to commend you for being here because you went to the breakfast and you're tripping out. That's the opportunity. You get in your car, leave. But you did not. You said, okay, I'll try it, you know. And you feel weird because all these guys are singing and they look like thugs and they look like they've been in the joint for a long time. And you're saying, but wait a minute, there's white people, there's brown people, there's black people. You know, it's like, what's happening? You see, is that Christ has changed our hearts. We're no better than you. The church is not an exclusive club. The Church of Jesus Christ is inclusive. That means that anybody and everybody's welcome, but there's one prerequisite. You got to be all jacked up. If you got it together, then God cannot help you. If you got it wired, and you got the answers for mortality, if you got the answers for the future, if you have the answers for hope, and if you have the answers for contentment and happiness, you don't need God. But if you don't have hope, you don't have love, you don't have embracement, you don't have salvation, you don't have forgiveness, you don't have assurance, you don't have the love of God upon you, you don't have the consciousness of a friend named Jesus in your heart, you're lost. And you're open season. So here's what I'm going to ask you. I'm not going to ask you to come up here. Time is not on my side. Right now, the enemy is my time. But if you're here right now, and you're a non-believer, in a moment, I'm going to ask you if you would like to receive him, and I'm asking you to stand up. And you're going to say, I won't stand up. I know you won't. See, but it's the heart of God. It is the Spirit of God coming upon you, and he will convince you that you got to get up. Because his word will come in you and speak to you. His words are louder than any probation officer, any general, any police officer. It speaks louder than any government speaker. It speaks louder than your girlfriend. It speaks louder than your mama. It is the word of God that convicts you. And you say, I got to do that now. The only thing that will prevent you, preclude you, from not accepting Jesus Christ is an element, characteristic that God hates, and that is pride. Don't let pride again mess you up. For once, be like a little child and say, I got nothing to lose, everything to gain.